Right now, I'm looking around our GPB studio with a thermal imaging camera that allows us to see heat given off by people and objects. And as you can see, this camera offers an entirely new perspective on how we see everything. If we could always see heat, we could avoid getting burned. We could see all sorts of animals hiding in the woods, and we could literally watch the sun's heat as it warms the earth. Even though we can't see heat without the help of special equipment like this, we can feel it and measure it. And as we all know, heat is necessary for life itself, so it's very important to understand. Thermodynamics is a branch of science that studies heat and related phenomena. And it's a topic we'll be exploring in detail in this unit of Chemistry Matters. Welcome to Chemistry Matters, Unit 8, Thermodynamics. Thermodynamics is a big word that might sound a bit intimidating, but if you take the word apart into thermo and dynamics, it's easier to see what it's really about. Thermo has to do with thermal energy, which is simply heat, and dynamics describes something that's moving or changing. So when we put those two words back together, it's easy to see that thermodynamics is concerned with the movement of thermal energy. And that makes sense. Heat is basically energy on the move. Or to use the more classic definition of heat, it's the transfer of energy from a warmer object to a cooler object. In other words, when there's a difference between the temperatures of two objects, thermal energy is transferred between them as heat. At this point, it's important to note the difference between heat and temperature. As I just explained, heat is a term that represents the movement or transfer of thermal energy. The standard unit of measure for energy, including thermal energy, is the joule, which is abbreviated as J. You may have heard the term calorie, and not just when talking about food, which is also a unit of energy measurement that scientists sometimes still use. Temperature, on the other hand, is a measurement of the average kinetic energy or molecular movement in an object or system. It's a comparative scale, based on comparing the hotness or coldness of an object to a reference, such as the freezing or boiling points of water. Molecules that have more movement have more kinetic energy, which is registered as temperature. And you can see the effect on the moving particles. Look at these beakers. One has hot water at 95 degrees Celsius, and the other cold water at 10 degrees Celsius. Now watch what happens when I add this food color. Do you see how much faster the color moves through the hot water? That's because of the faster moving hot water molecules. Measuring temperature allows us to predict in which direction heat will flow, which is always from a substance with a higher temperature or more molecular movement to a substance with a lower temperature, that is, a substance with lower molecular movement. Here you see faster moving hot water molecules slow down as some of their energy is transferred to the colder water molecules, which are now moving faster. We'll investigate the relationship between a change in temperature and heat transferred later in this unit. For now, it's important to know that not only can heat move from one object to another, it can also be transformed into other forms of energy. Thermal energy is often used to generate steam, which in turn can be directed to mechanically turn the blades of a turbine. This mechanical energy is then used to generate electricity. Thermodynamics is present all around us, around the clock, probably more so than any other area of science. In fact, it would be more difficult to think of an area of our lives that does not involve thermodynamics than to list the multitude of examples thermodynamics plays in our lives. The sun provides more thermal energy to the earth than any other source, but most of us use solar energy indirectly from the combustion of fossil fuels. One of the largest uses of fossil fuels is to generate the electrical power that carries light and heat to our homes. But all throughout the day, from getting breakfast out of the refrigerator in the morning, to starting a car and using a cell phone, and even as your own body exchanges heat with its surroundings, thermodynamics is at play in our lives. Scientists have discovered through countless experiments that there exists a series of natural laws that describe how heat and other forms of energy interact in our environment. Our world and all the reactions that occur are described by these laws. The first law of thermodynamics is also called the law of conservation of energy, and it's similar in nature to the conservation of matter we studied in Unit 5. Conservation of energy simply tells us that the amount of energy in the universe is constant. Energy can be transferred from one substance to another or transformed into other forms of energy, but it cannot be created or destroyed. In other words, energy can't just pop into existence out of nowhere or disappear the same way. The laws of thermodynamics describe the behavior of a system. We can study large systems, like the whole universe or a planet like Earth. A planet is an example of an open system, meaning that energy can be delivered from somewhere else, like the sun. In chemistry, we often describe smaller systems, such as a chemical reaction happening in one location. A chemical reaction can also be described as an open system, since energy can be provided from outside the system. It will be important to describe the system we're measuring, since energy can be transferred from a system to its surroundings. So, if energy lasts forever, why do we have to worry about conserving energy? That question drove scientists to discover the second law of thermodynamics, which tells us that energy always disperses or changes from a more usable form of energy to a less usable form. For example, the solar energy directly from our sun arrives to Earth in concentrated form, powering all of life as we know it. With each conversion of solar energy to other forms of energy, to wind, chemical energy through photosynthesis, and to electrical energy through solar panels, the energy becomes more spread out or dispersed and less usable. Because the Earth is an open system, the dispersed energy eventually escapes into space and becomes completely unusable to us. Fortunately, sunlight is constantly providing new energy to this system, our Earth. Without the constant renewal of solar energy, life would cease to exist. Entropy is the measurement of this energy dispersal. Entropy explains why heat travels from a warmer object to a cooler object and not the reverse. By traveling to a cooler object, thermal energy can spread out or disperse, as described by the second law of thermodynamics. Heat cannot travel from a cool object to a warmer object. Unfortunately, dispersed energy is less useful to us. For example, as electricity flows into our homes, the wires that carry the electricity heat up, dispersing some of the heat energy into the air and reducing the amount of electricity we receive. Most of the electrical energy that reaches our homes will be dispersed as mechanical energy, heat, or light. Eventually, all of the used energy will disperse into space. This dispersed energy is no longer useful to us. In summary, the second law of thermodynamics tells us that once energy is converted from one form to another, it is less effective energy. Energy dispersal, or entropy, is always increasing in our universe, and therefore, our energy resources are, in fact, depleting. Since entropy is a measure of the dispersion or spreading out of thermal energy, entropy is dependent on temperature. The lower the temperature, the less thermal energy is available to disperse or spread out, and therefore, the lower the entropy. In more simple terms, hot things have a lot of heat they can lose, so you'd measure a lot of entropy as that system loses heat. Very cold systems have very little energy to lose, so you measure only a small amount of entropy in those systems. Scientists have defined absolute zero as the temperature at which all molecular motion stops and entropy is zero. No colder temperature is possible since the system has lost all of its thermal energy. While a temperature of absolute zero does not actually exist in nature and cannot be obtained in the laboratory, it serves as a reference or starting point for both temperature and entropy. William Thomson, also known as Lord Kelvin of Belfast, Ireland, proposed a scale for measuring temperature based on absolute zero. His Kelvin scale, in common use by scientists, placed absolute zero at a value of negative 273 degrees Celsius. This Kelvin scale also serves as the basis for the third law of thermodynamics, which states that the entropy of a system at absolute zero is zero. Now that we've been introduced to the laws that describe the behavior of energy, let's visit our classroom to investigate how those laws affect the chemical processes around us.
Thermodynamics is primarily concerned with converting heat energy into more useful forms of energy. The sun is our fundamental source of heat and power. The sun's heat disperses throughout our atmosphere, the ground, and our oceans, controlling our weather patterns and our ocean currents. And much of this thermal energy is converted to electrical energy in the form of lightning, and some of it is converted into mechanical energy such as waves and wind. It's our observations of the thermodynamics that have allowed us to learn how to harness and use this thermal energy ourselves. And in this unit, we'll be examining chemical thermodynamics, or also referred to as thermochemistry, which is the study of energy changes that accompany chemical reactions or physical changes in the states of matter. And this knowledge will allow us to understand why some chemical reactions occur while others do not. And scientists have also used this knowledge to harness chemical energy and convert it to other forms of energy, such as heat and electricity. And so I'm handing each of you a hot and cold packet. And first, I simply want you to make observations. So how would you describe them?
Mine kind of feels like a powder.
They aren't hot or cold. They're both at room temperature.
It feels like there's a powder kind of granule in mine.
Good. There's actually a compartment inside of each of these containers. The outer pack contains only water, the liquid that you mentioned, and the inner compartment contains a chemical that dissolves in water. I'd like each of you to squeeze or shake your packs until you feel the inner compartment break. Then switch packs with your partner so you can feel the difference between the two.
Wow, mine's beginning to feel warm.
Mine's getting really cold. Here, you can take the cold one. I'll take the warm one.
So what do you think's happening in the hand warmer?
Well, when I shook it, I guess some chemicals mixed together because it got hot.
You're right. There are several different substances in the hand warmer to begin with, among them water and a water-soluble ionic compound. But where do you think the heat came from?
Did the ionic compound react with the water to make heat?
Well, not exactly. Dissolving by itself isn't considered a chemical reaction. It's a physical process. And if the water were removed by evaporation, which is also a physical process, then that same ionic compound would remain. The process of dissolving an ionic compound simply means that the ions that are in the ionic compound are surrounded by water molecules. In this case, the dissolving process is energetically favorable and it generates heat. And one of our goals in this unit is to understand why this dissolving process generates heat.
Wait, if dissolving generates heat, then how did the cold pack work? I thought you said both the hand warmer and the cold pack were ionic compounds dissolving in water.
Good question, Wyatt. Both processes do involve dissolving an ionic compound in water.
So how can dissolving generate heat one time and cold another time?
Well, it's all a matter of the direction of heat transfer. And at this point, I think it'll be helpful for us to learn some of the basic vocabulary and the processes involved in thermochemistry. But let's start by making sure you understand the difference between heat and cold. We've already learned that heat is the transfer of thermal energy. And we usually measure heat in units of joules. And those are named after the English scientist James Prescott Joule. Now, cold is simply the absence of heat. A substance feels cold to us because that substance is taking away heat from us. And cold is to heat as dark is to light. It's just a convenient term to describe the lack of heat. Now, heat always flows from the warmer substance to the cooler substance. In other words, heat, like all energy, spreads out or disperses over time.
So the cold pack didn't generate cold. It took the heat away from my hand, making my hand feel cold.
So where did the heat go?
That's a great question, Alexis. The heat taken by the cold pack was used to help dissolve the ionic compound in water.
I think I'm getting it. I'll bet the ionic compound in the hand warmer dissolves a lot more easily than the ionic compound in the cold pack.
You're absolutely right, Wyatt. But can you explain why?
Well, if an ionic compound dissolves easily in water, then it doesn't need help or heat.
Right. But if an ionic compound isn't very soluble, then it'll need some help, like extra energy to finish dissolving.
Good job of explaining how different systems can require different amounts of energy. We'll learn soon that the amount of energy that a process takes in or gives out depends on the relative energies of the starting and ending substances in a process. It appears that dissolving ionic compounds can either release heat or consume heat. So it's no wonder that scientists have made use of that information. Now I'd like you to imagine that you're scientists working in a lab, and you stumbled upon a series of aqueous solutions of ionic compounds that either get cold or hot as the compound dissolves. You think these processes could be very useful if you could figure out a way to control the amount of heat that's released or absorbed. And you realize that you need to understand processes better, so you decide to further investigate them with the hope of making better hand warmers and cold packs. So I'd like you to work with your partner and brainstorm and develop a specific and relevant question to further investigate the process for the hand warmer or the cold pack. Nathkrishna and Wyatt, you'll develop an investigative question to examine the cold pack. And Alexis and Caleb, I'd like you to develop one for the hot pack. Your question should be worded so it can be answered with experimentation. Once you have a carefully worded question, suggest an experiment designed to answer that question.
That was an interesting investigation of heat, and it leads to a lot of interesting questions. For instance, why would similar processes differ so much in their heat requirements? We'll take a quick break from this first video on thermochemistry to give you time to perform our teacher's assignment, coming up with a question and proposing an experiment, both designed to better understand and control the processes observed in the hand warmer or cold pack. When you're done, move on to the next video in the thermodynamics playlist, where we'll begin exploring several thermodynamic processes.